Hello and welcome to your induction part one. So in this video I'm going to cover things such as which bar to buy and why, how to use your bar correctly, the weights on the bar, bands, grips, so how the different types of grips, and then different types of posture for weight training. And then finally, I will go through explaining how to think when you're weight training, how to connect with your body. So it's kind of like weight training mindset, I suppose. So that's what we're going to cover in this one. And then in part two, we're going to run through the entire body, going through technique for each type of exercise, as much as possible anyway. I mean, you know, I'm always going to be narrating and talking when we're doing the training anyway and constantly prompting you, so you don't need to worry too much about it, but it's good just to dedicate some time to this, because obviously if you're starting a weight training journey and some muscle building, that is fabulous, and it's probably the best thing you could ever do for yourself, aside from eating well and getting your emotional state healthy. So if you're starting on a journey, well done, congratulations, so glad you're with me. And secondly, you know, it's like anything, if you start with poor habits, then they're very likely to carry on until somebody corrects you. And even then, you will have cemented that way of moving so firmly in your mind that it's very, very difficult to change it. So let's get it right to start with. Okay, so the first thing then really is the posture when you're weight training. Let's talk about that for a little bit. Oh, the bar was the first thing we're going to talk about. So the bar. Okay, so we've got, if you buy the MiraFit set, or if you're in America, you're probably going to buy a slightly different set. But what you're looking for, okay, these are the things that you need. Preferably the clip that comes with the bar. Preferably a squeezy one, or one that's very, very easy to take on and off of the bar. Some of them are like screw ones and they take ages to take on and off. You don't want that. You want something that is quick release. So when you're looking for a bar, that. Each bar costs, with the weights and the clips, about £50 roughly. Okay, I wouldn't recommend going for one cheaper than that. The next thing you want is a rubber covered weight. Preferably not metal, because they are really clunky, and these are nicer to hold with the holes through the middle like this, so that I can grip it and use it as a dumbbell. Yeah, with it, if it hasn't got holes through the middle, it's not as versatile. I can't use it as a dumbbell, and then I'm likely to have to spend more money buying dumbbells. The next thing about the weight is that this section, the hole where it goes onto the bar, preferably it should be metal edged, because that will let this slide. If you buy a weight that's got no metal ring on the inside, it jams as you're taking it on and off, which just slows you down during your workout and is bloody annoying. So that's the next thing. The weights come, this is a purple one, I often refer it to the purples. But you're all going to have different colours. So this is a 2.5 kg. So in pounds, God knows what that is. Is it 2 pounds to a kilogram? No, 2 kilograms to a pound, right? Oh my God. Who should know that? Me, I should know that. The bar itself, I've bought, this is a padded bar. Although if I bring it closer, you can see it's really not very padded. It's not very, very squidgy. But it is padded, and the reason I chose the padded bar is because we are using it to glute bridge, and therefore we're putting it on our pelvis, which means it's nice to just have that extra bit of padding if you've got bony pelvis, right, which a lot of people do have. Then, so the 2.5 weights are great, and then also the pink is a 1.25 on my set. My set is from Powerhouse, I believe they do not sell these anymore, but I bought a massive rack and then I just bought one home. So I've got racks of these in the gym that are mine. So that's a 1.25, and then the green is a 5 kg. This is completely and utterly adequate for you to start your weight training journey and will see you through for at least a year before you need any more weights than this, at least, because you've got to get your technique right first. So that's the bar, okay? Please try and avoid buying super cheap, crappy bars, because you just, your experience and your efficiency isn't gonna be very nice. And you want your experience to be good of weight training, right? Because we're always looking for reasons not to exercise, so you don't want any reasons not to. Okay, next up then, bands. I recommend, get a set of these. If you go onto eBay, these ones are called Redcore, or if you go onto Amazon, they'll be on there too. These are called Redcore. I'm not particularly recommending these, but I always buy this set because I'm happy with it. It's a set of 6 or 7 bands, all different colours, all different thicknesses. And it's nice to have all the variations of thicknesses, because sometimes you really need a thin band and sometimes you really need a thick one. These are about, £6-7. So really, really incredibly reasonable. And you can, it's astonishing how many different exercises you can do with just one of these. You can do a whole hour's workout easily with one of these. So yeah, grab that, and that will be your starter kit. That will do you for the very beginning, as I said. Okay, moving on then. So posture. Now, I have a very particular way that I like to stand when I am weight training. Now, some of you may know, some of you may not know, I have got 9 years experience working out in a gym doing weight training. I have got more than that. I've got more like 15 years of experience doing this type of weight training, like in a class or home situation, okay? So I started as a client and then trained as a personal trainer later on. So I've got a hell of a lot of experience doing this, and this is my recommendation. Other people may state otherwise, but this is what I recommend and what I have managed to not injure myself, right? And all of that time, using these techniques. So that's why I so strongly recommend them. When you are standing, I would like you to retain soft knees and soft hips. So I'm just going to change the camera a little bit so that you can see what I'm talking about. I'm going to take this down and keep the camera close, okay? So if you look at my legs, you will see that as I stand right now, my hips are slightly soft and my knees are slightly soft, okay? I don't know if you can tell or whether it looks normal. Hopefully I don't look too freakish, but if I lock out my knees and my hips, this is what I look like. Okay, so you definitely can tell the difference now I've changed it. This is soft and this is locked out. And then from the front, this is soft and this is locked out, okay? So what happens is most people, normally in the day when you're moving around, you will, whenever you're standing still, you will lock out your hips and knees. So you push your knees backwards and they are at full lockout. Now, so a lot of women hyperextend, they are double jointed. Their joints go too far backwards when they lock them out. So you'll see people with elbows that go up like this and knees that bow backwards like that. That is hyperextension. Now, if you hyperextend, you really don't want to be locking out your joints because you're putting them under huge amount of strain. So the reason I recommend to keep everything soft all the time, this includes elbows unless I state otherwise, is because I would prefer you to be holding your body up using your muscles as opposed to your joints. And the reason for that is that muscles will repair, muscles will get stronger. Joints sometimes don't repair at all, and they do degrade, whereas muscles won't. Muscles have the capability to get stronger. Okay, so the very different types of tissue, very different situations. So why wouldn't you use your muscle if it has the capability to repair itself? Good, I'm glad I've made my case there. So whenever I say standing hip width apart, knees soft, hips soft, that's what I mean. You're standing with your feet in line with your hips. Now my skeleton hips are here, and that's what I mean. If you've got hips this wide because of fat on top of your skeleton, I don't mean stand like that. I mean stand wherever your hip bones sit, okay? So it's quite narrow because the skeleton is very narrow. Knees are soft, hips are soft. The next thing is the upper body. So what we want to do is, I don't know if any of you have ever done ballet, but it is a very ballet type position that we're going to stand in. You're going to draw the shoulder blades down, and this will lift the chest slightly, which lengthens the abs. Okay, so we get nice long abs here. So when you're standing, whenever you're doing weight training, we've got hips, knees, sorry, hip width apart, knees, hips, rib cage slightly elevated, slightly, long abs, shoulder blades down. Okay, so I look like this. Now, an ordinary person normally stands like this. Okay? So we are bringing tension, actually it's down at the back here. We bring tension down at the shoulder blades and stand like this. Okay, it's like standing proud, like a cat or something, or a superhero. So this allows us to get oxygen in as well, and puts our skeleton all lovely and in line, especially the spine. And then the shoulders, we do not want them rolling forward like this, because of course if you slump here, the shoulders roll forward as a knock-on. When you stand like this, they go into neutral, exactly where they're supposed to be. So they kind of just fall by default into position. And I want you to practice this wherever you are, all day, every day, so that when you are weight training, it becomes completely natural to you. Next bit. Okay, so that is your position. Sometimes I will ask you to change your position so you just listen to my prompts. When we're squatting or doing sumo squats and stuff like that, we will take much wider feet. For lunging, it's very, very different, but we're going to run through those types of techniques in a minute in part two. Okay, so the last bit of this video then needs to be about what you're thinking when you're weight training. Now, you may never have even thought about how your mind needs to behave when you're exercising, but this is obviously the key, just like everything. Everything comes from here. This creates the intention, which creates the outcome. So in order to get yourself into really incredibly good habits in terms of your weight training, an incredibly good technique, which is going to maximize what you get out of each session, you've got to start here. When you go into the gym, you have decided to do a workout the minute you step in there. So your intention is that. Now, obviously, sabotage type behaviours and thinking are going to kick in. And that's okay. We just re-choose to focus. That's quite simple. I recommend using a timer, which is why I use a timer when I'm doing workouts with beginners, because it keeps you really, really focused. And it keeps you accountable to how much rest time you're having. So that's really important. You have to be incredibly disciplined if you work out without using a timer for your rests. Now, mind-muscle connection may be something you've heard of before, it may not be. This is something I became obsessed with very, very quickly when I started weight training, and I think it has been key to my success. You can connect mentally with the muscles that you are working. This means in normal day life, it doesn't have to be when you're weight training, but I'm referring to weight training. You simply, when you're working a muscle, let's have a weight. Okay, let's say I'm going to do a bicep curl, okay? And I'm doing a quarter turn here. If I put my hand on my bicep here, now you may not have much muscle, but if you just give your arm a tiny bit of a squeeze and then turn as you come up, do a quarter turn, and now just turn this a bit more, you're going to feel the bicep contract even more. So if you go from here to here, you're going to feel it just tighten up that little bit more. That means I'm just getting that little bit more out of this movement. Okay, so as I'm lifting into a bicep curl, the weight, I'm thinking, I'm sending my mind, I imagine it like Google Map, like a blue line that's going from here down into the target location, just like Google Maps. So I am thinking just and only about this whilst I'm working it. Okay, I'm dedicating my energy, my mental energy to this muscle. I'm also dedicating some of that energy to my posture and my breathing. Oh my God, we need to talk about breathing. Oh my God. Okay, so this, I'm dedicating that energy. I'm not leaving my energy at work with the argument I've just had, thinking about my dinner. No. Whilst I'm working out, I'm dedicating the energy I would normally be worrying or whatever it is, okay, about everything on the outside. No, whilst you're working out, it's like a meditation. You dedicate each moment to the muscle group that you are working during that workout. You are dedicating each moment to the breath that you need to keep yourself going and to stabilize your body, give your body what you need, oxygen. Okay, so this is very much a mind to muscle direct line to whichever area you're working. And then what I describe this as listening, okay, listening internally. So you go it within and you listen to what's happening inside your body. This is particularly important with areas like the glutes, because the glutes, the bum muscles, glutes is a tricky area, often very switched off, this muscle group. It seems to go into a coma. I certainly was suffering with this. And the glutes, you really have to concentrate on them to get them to start functioning. So we're talking about really getting the very, very most, every morsel, the best out of working your muscles. So we don't just look like we're doing the exercise like this. I'm doing it, I've been to the gym, and yet you're seeing no progress. You're actually connecting with it whilst you're doing it and taking the energy and the focus to that place. Brilliant. I expect this from you every time you work out with me, whether you're at home or whether you're with me live, it doesn't matter. This is what I want to see happening. Dedication. Breathing. Now again, people have different recommendations for breath control, and I'm always trying to keep up with the latest stuff, but again, I'm going to tell you what I find the most helpful. The rule of thumb that I use is that when you are experiencing the hardest part of a movement, you should breathe out, okay? The exception being probably when you're deadlifting, or squatting, where we hold the breath, and that's to stabilize the body, which I'll explain in a minute. But as a beginner, I would recommend that the moment you're experiencing the hardest part of a movement, you breathe out. For example, if you are doing a bicep curl with a bar, okay, this weight isn't particularly heavy, so the up movement is the hardest part for me. If I've got a really heavy weight and I'm going up quickly, that section's not too difficult because I'm using momentum. But when I'm lowering the weight slowly, that would be the hardest part of the movement for me. So I would breathe out there. takes a long time to get used to this, okay? And that's fine. As long as you're practicing, it eventually comes, and in my classes I see everybody doing this. It doesn't matter about making noise. We use the mouth to breathe out so that we've got lots of oxygen moving around the body to all the muscles to help them to work whilst we're working out. When you're squatting and when you're deadlifting, we're not going to deadlift on this channel. It's probably never going to happen. It would happen on my gym workout channel if it was going to be anywhere. But we hold the breath, and that helps stabilise the core. So you can do this when you squat. You create pressure in this cavity by holding the breath and pushing it down, because you've got a heavy weight on your back and you're about to squat with it. And it's for when you're lifting heavy. It is a technique that you can learn. Good! We're cracking through it, aren't we? I'm hoping that you're finding all of this very useful. Yes, so the mindset for a workout in a gym. People say that gym workouts are boring. I disagree. They are repetitive. They are repetitive. They are not boring. The repetition is necessary. There are only so many weight training exercises you can do per body part, and there are only so many variations of those exercises that exist. And the reason for that is those exercises work. And there are only so many ways your body can move. Obviously, there are a lot of different ways of combining those movements, but there are only so many ways that your body can move, right? So we are going to find ourselves doing the same exercises. But if those exercises work in terms of getting us the body that we want, the shape that we want, the muscle that we want, the strength, the stability, then why does it matter? It doesn't, as long as it works, right? So the repetition, you should take the time then, because repetition can create mastery, right? We know this. So become the master of your weight training. Become the master of your body. If you're having to repeat a movement, see it. Use your perspective, use your mind to change your perspective from boredom to an opportunity to become a master. Just like playing the piano, the violin, or whatever it is that you want to become incredible at, you take the opportunity and you make it happen. So I hope this video is really helpful to you. It applies to all situations, really. Whether you're gymming it or home workout, or doing home workouts with me. I will keep reminding you of this. There will be constant prompts of all the things that I've just said, so don't worry, you don't need to remember it all. But just let it start going in and start. I really want you to enjoy your experience. So that you'll continue. Lovely. Thank you very much. Any questions, please ask away.